I want to talk a little bit about some of the controversial things that we're doing in TRADOC to build those organizations. And I want to start by saying that everything I'm about to talk about is pre-decisional. These are recommendations to the Chief of Staff of the Army. They are the issues that we're considering. He will also make that point tomorrow, because people get very excited about the potential implications of this. So I would say these are the recommendations of crazed general officers at Training and Doctrine Command. First, the return to 3 battalions per BCT. I can show you 8 years worth of studies that talk about the need for a 3rd maneuver battalion. And I can talk about, not only at the tactical level, but at the strategic level, the flexibility and adaptability that that allows you. And I think that we are working through the math of that right now. When you think about the reduction, the chief has announced the reduction of 8 BCTs. You can talk about the realignment, in fact, of some of those maneuver battalions. We actually did this in the wrong sequence. We started talking about 3 maneuver battalions before we acknowledged a cut to 490,000. And everybody thought that was, oh my God, what are you trying to do? When you say you're going to lose a brigade at this installation, but oh, by the way, you're going to get to keep 2 of the maneuver battalions, it sells a lot better. And I think a lot of people will view that in the context that I just gave it. Engineer battalions, many of you know, we have taken the engineer battalion out of the brigade. That worked for us in fairly mature theaters. It does not work for us in the full spectrum operations that we see in unified land operations. Types and number of BCTs, I think you'll see us moving to a lighter set. I think as we draw down, I think we'll probably see a transition from some of the heavies. We'll keep an adequate number of heavies for the world contingencies. We'll also call them armor brigades, is our recommendation to go back in that direction. We're looking at tactical wheeled vehicle strategy. We think we have too many trucks in the United States Army, and we have a number of initiatives to reduce those numbers. Part of that problem is the number of communication systems that we have slaved to those trucks, and again, how we work that, and back to the idea, it fundamentally challenges the issue of modularity. We are where we are today with the number of trucks because of modularity. We didn't want to go back to the division base to get assets, so we pushed that all down to the brigades, and in fact, now we're having to deal with some efficiencies associated there. And again, reassessing the modular design, there are puts and takes on each of our formations, the striker, the infantry, and the armor, that we'll go back and address an overall assessment in terms of their capabilities and what they need. The idea of regional alignment, you've probably heard about. I'm very excited about it because I think in dealing with this young generation of warfighters, they're very interested in maintaining their energies in the world that they live in and not necessarily in notional training scenarios. So I think the ability to link to combatant commanders, meet the combatant commander's needs in terms of aligned units, and we're working through the specific mechanisms, assigned, aligned, apportioned, and working through the combatant commanders in terms of what that would be. Generally speaking, it would not mean that state units stationed in the United States would be, in fact, under the control of the combatant commander, but they, in fact, would remain under the Army's control on a day-to-day basis. Advisory capability, that's the central issue. A lot of folks arguing about the need for advisory organizations. We got ourselves into this SFAT organization, essentially taking a brigade's worth of leadership and sending it to Afghanistan. It was the right thing to do. It's what the combatant, it's what the theater commander wanted. But in fact, it's causing some second and third order effects as we think through the type of organizations that we want in the future. Lots of discussion about collapsing an echelon of command above the division level. And this would be some form of consolidation between the Army Service Component Commanders and the role of our Corps Commanders. And again, how do we do a better job of advocating the Army's capabilities to the combatant commanders by assigning or aligning our Corps headquarters with the primary missions, or the primary emphasis of the defense planning guidance in terms of the Pacific and in terms of CENTCOM. And again, we're looking at that. It'll be some form of a hybrid, we think, will be our recommendation. Again, theater engagement groups to assist in the utilization of regionally aligned brigades. ACRC balance, I can tell you that I think that has been a very healthy discussion that we've had thus far. General Ingram and the TAGs, as we've worked together. We think they have been very forthright in trying to understand what we want in terms of the shift of enablers. I think they know what they're good at, and they want to do that and support us. So I'm very pleased thus far with our discussions. And then the issue of reversibility and expansibility. And I have real concerns about the term. I used to talk about this extensively, and we kind of realized we were creating a problem because we were talking about reversibility so much. Perhaps people were overly relying on it and not doing the level of due diligence and analysis that we probably needed. So we've kind of backed off the use of the term reversibility. It will be a central feature, but the point I make about reversibility really deals with reversibility in our force will probably mean some level of inefficiency in terms of maintaining capabilities that we would describe as, you know, tooth-to-tail ratio, overhead, number of officers that, in fact, someone would look at and say, let's cut those guys out. Well, keeping a battalion commander or keeping a lieutenant colonel with 15 years in TRADOC is probably a pretty good deal, because if you need them again in the operational force, you can move them back over. Next slide. People, really exciting things going on. I think sometimes I'm a little frustrated that I don't think the operational force knows as much about the things that we're attempting to do in the schoolhouse. I think if you're in one of the TRADOC schoolhouses, you're fully aware of a lot of these initiatives. But sometimes I think the operational force, we are who we are because we focus on the fight. But the fact of the matter is, these youngsters need to know when they come out of the fight that in fact these programs are in place for them. The Army profession, many have heard about that. It is a systemic Army-wide assessment of where we stand after 10 years of war. This is being led by the Center for the Army Professional Ethic at West Point and under CAC, under Dave Perkins' leadership. And we basically have asked the force, what do we need to do to go into the future? Again, that's better than us telling them what they need to do. And in fact, what we found is this force is very hard on itself. And it has to do fundamentally with a return to some basic discipline, some basic emphasis on mentorship, and leadership programs. And again, this will be rolling out. I think April 2nd will be the rollout to the force on this, and the final, or actually the interim report after the first year of study. Army leader development strategy is my assessment that we are an Army that is out of balance significantly. If you talk to most of the guys in the back of the room here, it all comes down to experience. The number of combat tours that they've had, where they've served, and that has taken us out of balance from the traditional model that we've used in the Army that talks about institutional training, self-development, and experience. And again, they don't place much stock in those other two. And in fact, it's the Army's responsibility to change the policies, develop the timelines, and align the system, the personnel system, such that we can go back to a system that is, in fact, balanced on the three elements of training, education, and experience. And we need to, because as you understand, when we come out of Afghanistan, the ability to rely solely on experience will be gone. How do we take that combat experience and share it across the force in a better way? And again, also lots of discussion on talent management. I think most of us would agree that we've always managed the top 10% of talent in our Army, but that doesn't really get at what are the talents in the other 90% of the Army. Some of the initiatives that we've taken, a program called the Green Pages in the Corps of Engineers, where young engineer officers get online and basically communicate with units, offering their capabilities, find a match, the branch stamps off on it, and they get assigned that way. This is very exciting to a younger generation of officers who frankly don't understand the officer assignment process and think that we could do a better job using digital technology and communication.